Welcome, friends, to this afternoon session of our monthly meeting. I'm very glad to see all of you. Beautiful seekers, your souls are so bright, and you have come to a point in your life when you want to say, I want to go and find out the truth. That's why you're here. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. You may still have a different idea of what you're looking for, what the truth is. Whatever you're looking for, that's what you'll find. Some people are looking for going to heaven. I can tell you, if you're looking seriously, you will go to heaven. If you're very serious, you can go to heaven while still in the same body, or you might go later. If you have no idea what heaven looks like, you can make this world into heaven. Have a good time here, it'll be heaven. You say it's paradise right here. Or you go to Hawaii on the Waikiki beach, and then the beach there, and say it's heaven, it's paradise. People call it paradise. It depends what you seek. But if you seek the ultimate truth, and that comes only from a seeking from the soul, not from the mind. The mind seeks things which give you pleasure. Mind gives you things which you seek, which make you happy here. Mind is confined to things that is accepting here. Mind cannot even think of something beyond itself. The seeking that I'm talking of, which takes you beyond the mind, does not come from thinking or the mind. It comes from beyond it. And it is revealed to you more and more if you be in the company of an enlightened person who is beyond the mind. It comes automatically. Therefore, if that's the kind of seeking, and you've been able to find out that you have a perfect living master in your life, has come, appeared at the right time, what should be the next step? Next step will be to spend as much time as you can with that person. What is the most important part of a spiritual journey to our true home beyond the mind? The most important part is how much time you can spend with that perfect living master outside or inside. Since outside is only a human being with very little time to spend with more than so many people, more than one person. Inside is 24/7. Therefore, if you find that you cannot find enough time outside, it should be urgent for you to find time with that perfect living master inside. Sometimes we say that when you meditate, you see the radiant form of the master. Many people say, we are very keen to see radiant form quickly. Why do they want to see radiant form? What's the difference between the radiant form or any other form of the master? What's the difference between a form that you see outside and the radiant form? How is the radiant form more important than the form outside? Or for that matter, how is the radiant form more important than your remembering your master you saw in physical form? There's no difference whatsoever. There's a big mistake we make, that maybe we are not seeing the master because we don't see his radiant form. It's a very highly overrated thing. Radiant form comes when our attention has moved so much away from what is happening outside and moved inwards, which is very difficult, especially in these days when the engagements and our distractions outside are so many, including our obligations which have been created by the modern technology in modern world. Not easy. So why wait for something that comes with time and difficulty, depending upon when you reach that point that you have no more obligations outside and you can put all your attention inside and then see radiant form, when the equivalence is the same? You see outside or you see in your imagination and mind through memory. But this is the most important. Therefore, somebody asked me, I want to meditate regularly. Should I repeat the words more frequently? That will make it more meditation. I said, no. It will make you like a parrot. Parrot can repeat very frequently if you teach it. What will make effective is if you are remembering the master. And there are many ways of doing it. And I'll tell you one that works very good. We repeat mantra, we repeat words, we repeat simran in order to block the mind from thinking of other things. That's one function of repetition. Why not think of the master and repeat in front of him? Why not make the master repeat in your imagination? And why not you and master repeat together in your imagination? And eventually, master alone repeats. You sit in front of him and listen to his repetition or anything he says. Your attention is drawn inside and you are having the darshan of your master. The most important part, the darshan of a master. And you can have it, if you want, 24/7. You will see, if you associate every event of your life with your master, something good has happened. Thank you, master. You see him smiling. He's saying, yes, enjoy. Something bad happens to master. What is this? He says, I'm sorry. You're still remembering him? You're having his darshan all the time. You can make your life into a darshan of master. It's great to get that. And you do not have to wait for radiant form to have the darshan of a master. If you imagine him, but not imagine from a picture, not imagine by creating your own image of what a master is. Imagine from a memory of master as you saw him. That's life. You saw the master live. And now you're recalling how you saw. And that's darshan. Of course, when you get a chance to physically meet the master or the radiant form later, then in addition to darshan, you get drishti of the master. That means he looks at you. It is even more valuable. So these are the most important steps in our successful meditation for going beyond the mind. So I wanted to mention this because I received a lot of emails. People, oh, I haven't got the radiant form of the master so far. It's not easy. There's so much to be done in terms of diverting our attention from what we are doing here. And we are required to do that by our karma. We have no choice. Our karma obligates us to do so many things. Our obligations are there created by our own karma. And therefore, it's not always a choice. You can't give up everything and say, no, I'm going to do meditation. Your mind will run back to what you've given up. People say, we are going into the top of a mountain to meditate. We're going into the forest to meditate. People have tried all that stunts. They don't work. Because it's not a question of where your body location is. It's a question of where your mind is. Your mind is still in the same place. It doesn't matter where you are. I used to give an example that I came to the country. I liked a pizza. It used to be called Shaky's Pizza. I thought that was an attachment. Maybe I should run away from the store where they sell Shaky's Pizza. I ran away. Shaky's Pizza was in my head. I happened to tell this story to my friends, like I'm telling now. And I have received literally hundreds of emails with pizza, Shaky's Pizza picture on it. I can't run away at all now. The distractions that keep us here are so strong, running away is not possible. And that is why, so don't say that I haven't had the radiant form. That requires complete shift of your attention from here inside. But if you remember your master, you get a chance to meet. I can tell you, no matter how much I might love my pizza, if great master appears here, I'll forget all about it. That's what happens. Where there is love, other things get wiped out. The love and devotion is the most powerful thing. Love and devotion is the secret of going beyond the mind. Introduce love and devotion in everything that you do. Not meditation. You're doing your daily chores. Wow, this happened. Good. Your love grows for the master whose hand you can see. Because you can also see at the same time, this wouldn't have happened but for some intervention. And these interventions become observable. And you are able to see, this is Master's hand in this. Something is happening bad, I'm running into accident. Such a big accident happened, I'm unscathed, I'm not hurt. Master, you must have put your hand somewhere. These are the things that happen every day in our life. And every moment we can be thinking of the Master, remembering. And you can see him participating with you, laughing, smiling. So this is a good way to remember that love and devotion is the secret. Even great Master disciples, so many of them, meditated so hard. And they failed. And they came to Master, we failed. He said, no, you passed. No, we didn't get anything. We meditated so hard. He said, that was the purpose of meditation, to show you. You can meditate as hard as you like. You won't get anything. You get it by love and devotion. Put love and devotion into meditation. You rise. So one should never forget this very important factor. That since we want to go beyond the mind, therefore, love and devotion counts. The other is a mechanical thing, mental thing, to reach halfway. That's it. So I am glad to remind you that since you are all following this spiritual path to go beyond the mind, so please add love and devotion to every aspect of your life, and including in meditation. Do you have any question? Okay, I'll take up a few questions for you.
Sir, I am married and God initiated. How can we channelize the feeling of lust to get it transformed to meditation, or suppress the feeling lust and do our meditation?
I am married. I'm repeating the question. I am married and I got initiated. How can we channelize the feeling of lust to get it transformed to meditation, or suppress the feeling of lust and do our meditation? There is no connection between the two. If you're married, it's an obligation. If you want to control your lust, don't get married. And even then you won't control it. I'm a man, I'm a human being. You are all human beings too. We know about it. One of the last things that goes. Lust is very powerful. We can't just say, I want no lust, and lust goes away. I want no anger, and anger goes away. I want no pride, pride goes away. They don't. These things don't go away just by wishing them to go away. They do not go away, according to the spiritual teachers, till you have crossed the mind. They say that when you cross the mind, there is a great pool. It's just a physical description. Great pool into which you jump like crows and come out like swans. And the five vices which we are talking about, they walk away like little children saying bye-bye. That's when they leave. They don't leave us before that. So to say that we can suppress it, control it, mind will be on that all the time. People try to practice celibacy. Lust overwhelm them. And they can't meditate. In fact, I heard that there was a mistake in the Buddhist scriptures, that there was an American investigator who went to see the monasteries in Tibet and India and all those monasteries of Buddhists. So he saw in those monasteries that all the monks, young monks, were busy writing, reciting and writing. They were writing, copying the scriptures of the Buddhists from old manuscripts, because old manuscripts were first written on the bark of a tree, and then they were transcribed when paper was invented, and from paper gets old, and they can't read, they're writing with fresh ink now, which is better ink available now. So all transcribing from there. So he, being inquisitive, he said, these young people are writing everything from the old scriptures. Supposing one makes a mistake in writing, then from there, that will become the scripture, and others will start copying that. The mistake will perpetuate forever. How do you protect it? So in one of the monasteries where this happened, the abbot, the head monk there, he said, no, from time to time, what they write here, we check with the originals, which we store in the basement of our monastery. He says, for example, I check up now. So he went down and he was screaming, didn't come out. After a while, the leading monk said something has happened. He also went down. He also didn't come out. He said, the American investigator said something has gone wrong. So he went down and the head monk was screaming, we made a mistake. Mistake of R. Now they said, what is mistake of R? Have you ever heard of mistake of R? The word in the original was celebrate. We missed the R and called it celibate. Not a joke, I must tell you. The point here is that celibacy has never been able to help in meditation. And so many celibates are there, I come across those people. And all they've been trying to do is to suppress something. Suppression has never done anything. Then there are some, there's a certain class of yogis in India who say suppress nothing. They overdo everything. They say, satisfy yourself with everything that you want, including all the five vices, till you get tired of them. And the mind says, that's the best yoga. The mind encourages them. They never get tired of that. The mind loves to have all kinds of associations with what is happening outside in the world. So that is why it is a balance we keep. A balance that we have certain functions in the body that have to be performed. Supposing somebody does not have any of these five vices, do you know he can never become a seeker? Supposing, let's say, you have no lust at all, and lust is an expression in the physical world of love. People lustful, they say it's love. We love you. Remove lust, for some time, even their idea of love will disappear. What about pride, ego? Hankar, person says, I am there. Supposing we abolish that, there's no I, there'll be no seeker. You need an I to be a seeker. The very things which we call vices are also virtues at a certain point in this world, in the physical world. That is why it's a very big balance that we have to keep between the practice of our obligations and duties in this world and the practice of meditation within. It should be taken like this. We have to live according to the duties we have to perform in this world and also have the ability to go within and search what is there and compare. There are two things, karma and dharma. And according to Hindu philosophy, that karma creates our obligations here, which is our own actions of past lives that force us to do certain things here. Marriage is one of those things. Lustful activity is one of those things. Friendships are one of those things. All these are based upon previous karma. They come and obligate us to do certain things. And when we do those things, they can be vices or virtues. Depending upon, are you paying off your karma? Or are you denying paying off the karma? If you're paying off your karma, it's virtue. If you're saying, no, I won't want to do, I am a celibate, you're postponing the karma for another future life. Therefore, it doesn't help. Dharma means do your duty according to your karma. Karma is paid off by dharma. Dharma means duty. It's your duty to fulfill those obligations that you created from out, from behind, from previous lives. When you perform your actions, including lustful activity, based upon your karma of the past, you're clearing it up. Now, there's one interesting point in this law of karma. That when you finish your obligation arising from a duty created by circumstances, you've ended the karma. If you want to proceed further with the same thing, you're creating new karma. So once you say, this is a duty I've done, finished. But if you say more, new karma. Then you are repeating the same cycle. Supposing somebody gets angry with you and fights with you, you can say to yourself, this must be old karma. He's getting it back to me. Thank you. karma ends. Suppose you fight back, you create a new one. You fight again. It's a very interesting way to live life and reduce karma by fulfilling your dharma, your obligations that are required by karma, and not creating new ones. So it is nothing wrong when you say you are married. Yes, continue to observe all the obligations of marriage, including the main purpose of marriage used to be to produce children, which is lustful activity. It's a sexual activity. So you can't say, I won't deny that, and I've got married. So you have to fulfill your duties, obligations, and don't create more new desires for new things, like similar things. Then you don't create more karma. You fulfill it. While you are doing your duties, don't extend the karma and go within and find out what else is there inside. And it'll work beautifully. It's only when we have desire for more outside beyond the dharma or fulfilling the karma that more karma is not only created, distraction is created in meditation. Distraction is not created by fulfilling karma. Distraction is created by creating new karma. So that is why you have to balance your life very carefully, that do what is required as dharma from the past karma, don't create new ones, have less distraction for the future, and go within.
From a karmic perspective, why have the number of single people increased all over the world, and also the number of breakups and divorces?
From a karmic perspective, why have the number of single people increased all over the world, and also the number of breakups and divorces? From karmic perspective, that's how the development of life on this planet has to go on. On this planet, we have to have more population. We have to wipe out population of certain species and create more population of other species. And that's happening. In the process, the obligations of relationships are changing. And as they change, the people who want to be single increases. The reason is a discovery of what happens if you are married. There's a friend of mine. There was a girl who came to India and met me. Her name was Emily. And she's passed away, so I can take her name. And Emily fell in love with a guy, Charles Ross. They lived in Nevada. And they were so much madly in love, they told me they were soulmates. And they married. Within a few days of marriage, they were arguing about petty things, like what to eat, what to wear. I mean, simple things. They couldn't agree on those. Love began to disappear. Honeymoon ended. And then the fight started. And they said, this is terrible. Way to live. We are not made for each other. So they divorced. They divorced and they loved each other as friends. They said, this is wonderful. Actually, we are made for each other. And they remarried. Same Emily and Charles. They remarried. Next day, the problem started. And they couldn't explain why they don't agree on anything. And after a year or so, they divorced. Again, after divorcing, they felt very good for each other. And they remarried again. 3 times they married the same person again. What happens with marriage, I want to know. What does marriage do to us? As people become more what they call independent, it can be self-centered, it's the same thing. And we are in the course of this development of the what they call civilization. It's a civilizing process. It's civilizing ourselves, we become more self-centered and more independent. As we become like that, we are more interested in what happens to us and less conscious of what happens to somebody else. There's natural growth like that. In that, when we are not married and we think we are in love with somebody, we put our best foot forward. We show our best. We don't show our weaknesses. We show the best we can, both sides. And we love each other for that. In marriage, oh, now we are together, we take each other for granted. And all the other things come up which we don't show when we're not married. From this point of view, it appears that marriage can never lead to a long-term lovey-dovey relationship like people expect. I have met so many people in my life who came to me and took my advice. Two people, we love each other, we are soulmates, we know each other, we have known, we dated each other for so long. Should we marry? I said, blessings, marry. 6 months later, we were never made for each other. Bless us for a divorce, blessing. What can I do? I know the pattern. I have seen this pattern all over the world, not any particular culture. So that is why, because of this pattern and growth of our own self-interestedness, the number of single people is increasing all over. People are willing to stay together, live in together, and not marry, thinking that's more beneficial than marrying. Sometimes people say, we'll not marry, we live together. After some time, they say, we should get married. Where do these obligations of marriage, of living together, come from? Past karma. They're not being created right now. We think they are. They're all past karma. The reason why single people are growing is a natural growth. What happens in the total creation of this universe? This has not been first time created, let me tell you. This has been created several times. And every time we think we are civilizing ourselves, then we grow up to a certain point. Then we destroy ourselves. Every time we raise our standard of living, we raise more and more attention to physical activities, physical comforts that we want. We do all that and keep on growing. And then the destructive part of the mind comes in. Jealousies come in. Arguments come in. Self-centeredness creates the battles between us and between nations. And then we use all the power we developed and we kill ourselves. And we kill the planet. This has happened many times over and will happen many times. It's a natural cycle. So we are at a point right now where you can see the middle point where this is happening, what has been mentioned in this question. Number of single people is increasing and the number of breakups and divorces is also increasing. Just right at this time. One more question.
What kind of marks, traits, or characteristics do marked souls have? Can only a PLM identify them, or others also can?
What kind of marks, traits, or characteristics do marked souls have? Can only a PLM identify them, or others also can? Marked souls have no physical mark. There's nothing you can see on them to say who's a marked soul. Because, as we rightly say, they are marked souls, not marked bodies, not marked sense perceptions, not marked mind. They are marked souls. We don't even know where our soul is. How can we see anybody else's soul? Therefore, we can never know who is a marked soul. Perfect living masters, when they look at us, even in the body, they don't look at us. They look at the soul. They see the readiness of the soul to end an experience that is happening here and take them back home. Perfect living masters do not come to teach anything. They do not come to explain anything. They do not come to tell any stories. They come to take the marked souls back home, which match their list. They come as human beings, ordinary human beings. Therefore, they need a list and they need to know where those people are. So they know where they are. But when they meet those seekers, they do not look at the body, the senses, or the mind of that person. They look at the soul of that person. And that's why the soul feels there's something different in the presence of such a perfect living master. And so only souls are marked. And there is no sign on a soul. It has no body. It has no, it's got nothing. It's not even time-space. It's got nothing that we can describe here. A soul has nothing at all that can be described here. When we say, maybe light, you can't have light without space and time. It's, nothing can describe a soul except the description, it's a unit of consciousness. It's the ability to have an experience. That's the soul. And perfect living masters only can identify a soul and they take them back home. Thank you very much for your kind attention to these few words I have to share with you. What I share here is not based upon any books that I've read. And I'm saying this because people sometimes ask me questions, which book did you read this from? Then I have no answer. Or they sometimes ask me, we see in the same book there's a contradiction. Which one is correct? Great master's books, they're telling me. Great master statements. Great master statement told somebody at the time of initiation, the sinchit karma, the reserved karma, is destroyed. Only the prarabdha karma which you come up with, which is required for your body to survive here and to become a seeker, sustained. If you have to come again, no part of sinchit karma can play any role. Only the prarabdha karma and karma you create now can be used for the next life. Very clear. Another person came who believed in a teaching given by another master. He said, Master, is all sanchit karma destroyed here? Not necessarily. It can be destroyed to the extent that you have other lives to come. You've been initiated in advance. And therefore, some of your karma may be destroyed in the higher regions right up to Trikoti. Which one is correct? Both are correct for those two souls, for those two persons. One letter master writes, meditation doesn't take anywhere, anybody. It's only love and devotion and grace of the master that takes you. Another letter he writes, do your meditation regularly. Without that, you'll get nothing. Which one is correct? Both are correct. I have personally heard masters say different answers based upon the person to whom they're talking. We read their letters written to individuals and think they are general teachings for all of us. They are not. What is teaching for us is what we get from a personal, perfect living master. We can never succeed in meditation or in getting enlightened by reading as much as you like about previous masters. You ask your questions from an existing, perfect living master. He will give you the answer you need at that time. You ask the same question 2 years later, he'll give you a different answer. Today's answer can be, do more meditation. 2 years later, the answer can be, you've done enough meditation. Now just relax and think of master. Both are correct. So that is why I want to make it clear, because so many people write to me showing contradictions in statements, that what I share with you is experiential, not based on books. Not based on what masters are teaching anywhere to anybody. And they are a personal recollection of my own experiences. And that's why I share with them. And therefore, when you communicate with me, tell me your experience. We deal with it at that level. I am doing this work only as my service, seva, to my master. I'm doing it exactly as I did something else with him. He asked me to get a road built. I had connections with the government. He said, get a road built. It's a very dirt road from the main road in the Amritsar district to the Dera. I went, worked, and got the road done. Today what I'm doing is no different from that. I was little. I wanted to fan the master. The fan was too big. The people who were fanning him, because there was no electric power, no fans, it was very hot there in the summer, I like to do that. And they would say, no, you're too small, too young. I was standing near the master, great master, and wanted to hold the fan. They were saying, no, you're too young. Great master said, give him the fan. I fanned him. Same seva, no difference. Do not think seva is different. It's the same no matter what you are doing. So long as you're serving the master. Supposing master is not there. You serve the people in the name of the master. Thinking of master, master, you are in everyone. I'm serving everybody. Same seva. Do not think there's different qualities and levels of seva. I am saying these things because I have seen myself people saying, oh, he got a better seva, he got a higher seva, or a smaller seva. There's no difference. I am very happy that he gave me opportunity to serve him through what looks like serving you. I don't think like serving you. What have I to get from you guys? I am getting from him. But it is seva to him that makes me come and share these things with you. Thank you very much.